dog fighting.
Time can make you blind, but I see you now as we're laying in the darkness. Did I wait too long?
All right, we all love that song. Here's the deal. It's been 31 years since Billy first declared that he would never record a pop song again. And the reason you're hearing that song is because of our guest right here, the man who somehow convinced him to record another pop song, Freddy Wexler. Wow. Producer extraordinaire, by the way. Freddy, how do you do it?
Well, I think, I don't know, maybe it was the right place, right time. A lot of things came together.
We heard your story at the Grammys profiled you.
Yeah, yeah.
Your wife had a doctor that was in common with Billy. You get to meet Billy.
Yep.
He somehow decides to meet you. He has no, like, he doesn't even care to meet you, but he meets you.
Meets me. Orders lunch to go.
But how does the topic come up to record again?
Well, at a certain point, I said to him, I said, Billy, I don't believe that you can't write songs anymore or that you won't write songs anymore. And he kind of said nonchalantly, you can believe whatever you want to believe. And I'm like, right, okay. But I wanted to keep the conversation going. So I said, I took out my phone. I said, you know, I have all these voice notes. I walk down the street, I hear melodies, I record them in here. I never finish them. Do you have anything like that? Any songs, any ideas you started? He goes, sure, I have unfinished ideas from the 70s and 80s. And I just took my shot and I said, well, why don't you let me finish them? And this was at our first lunch, okay? He had ordered his lunch to go. But now we had kind of hit a rhythm and we found that we had a number of things in common. And he looks at me and he goes, I should let you finish my songs? I said, I don't know. I feel like there are two possible outcomes here, right? You know, one that's highly probable is I do a terrible job, but who cares? And then the song stays unfinished. But I said, what if I do a half decent job? Even if it's still not good enough, it inspires you to finish something. And essentially, he was like, come to my house, sit at the piano, play me the best songs you've ever written. And so I went to his house, I sat at the piano, I played him some songs, and a day or two later, I had a FedEx from Billy Joel and a CD with his unfinished music from the 70s and 80s. Good luck.
Oh my God. Holy.
Yeah.
When you get that, you're probably like sweating bullets.
Oh yeah, it was like, felt like I got, it was like the Ten Commandments. It was some ridiculous, oh, what do I do with this thing?
So did you work on that music?
Yeah, so unbeknownst to basically anybody, we spent about a year and a half working on his unfinished stuff and going back and forth on lyrics and concepts and melodies over email, building a real friendship, and with no sort of expectation or pressure of where any of this stuff would go. My whole thing with him was, look, your music has helped me through some of the toughest times of my life. Your music has given me a tremendous amount of joy. And it makes me kind of sad that I feel like you lost the fun in it again. Let's just try to have fun. Like, that was it. And so at every step of the way, I really mean this, I wasn't trying to do much more than just get him to put his toe into the water of writing again. But then it became something, you know, more real. And a year and a half in, I said, look, I know we've been working on your unfinished songs. I have an unfinished song. Maybe you could help me finish it. I started it with two great songwriters, Wayne Hector and Arthur Bacon, good friends of mine. And it resonated with Billy, and he helped me finish it. And that became Turn the Lights Back On.
Wow.
Yeah.
Isn't that an amazing story? Yeah. And Freddie, I mean, I gotta say, like, Freddie's an accomplished songwriter himself. I mean, you wrote a number one song for Ariana Grande and Justin Bieber, and I mean, you've written for Kanye West. I mean, you've written for the gamut. I mean, is it different recording for an idol like Billy Joel?
Oh yeah, I mean, listen, I've been super blessed with a career. I pinch myself every day, having gotten to work with some of these artists. But yeah, I mean, listen, when there's somebody who is really the soundtrack of your childhood and sort of the reason you largely became a songwriter, and you get to work with that person, and it's kind of historic because they haven't worked with anybody in decades, it hits a little bit different, you know?
I'm gonna try to break some news right now. When are we going to see these unfinished recordings?
Oh, wow.
Are we going to see them?
You know, there's that Emily Dickinson line, I dwell in possibility. I think anything is possible. Anything is possible. And I wouldn't have said that, well, I always say
31 years ago?
Right. No, but the truth is, as I believe if music stays fun for Billy, and or in his words, not painful. I think anything really is possible. There's some great stuff in there, and we'll see what happens.
Could you see in his eyes that you had reinvigorated him so late in his career? Because, I mean, like, we were discussing this backstage. There's nobody of Billy's caliber that has pulled a move like that to where he stopped recording in the prime of his career.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to say I look in his eyes and I reinvigorated him. I mean, he reinvigorated me. He reinvigorated me, I can tell you that.
Well, I just want to know, are we going to see like new albums? And
Yeah. Like, so look, I think anything is possible. But to your point, I will say that I think this process was really cool and kind of transformative for both of us. I was at a place in my career where, even though I was at the height of it, and I'd had like just whatever, a string of big songs, I was kind of like, am I good enough? Should I do something else with my life? Would my idols, people like Billy Joel and Stevie Wonder and Paul McCartney, would they ever listen to one of my songs and go, not bad, kid? Would that ever happen? And if not, I'm not good enough. I don't care about 10 Billboard number ones or however many songs you, it's just like, are they good? And so I got the validation for Billy, you know, to be like, oh, I guess I'm okay. I guess I should do this. I should keep doing this. So to recommit to my dream. But I think for him, it was, you know, it did open up a new side of him and more fun. And I'll just tell you this, because you're I feel like you'll relate to this. Where are you from?
Jersey.
Okay.
I'll tell you what. Let's continue this conversation later.
Yes,
I have to toss to break now.
Toss to break.
But on behalf of all Billy Joel fans, I do want to thank you.
Let's go.
Freddy Wexler. Wow. Thank you so much.
Of course.
To learn more about Freddy, visit freddywexler.com. We'll be right back.
Right now, though I used to be romantic, I forgot.
All right, and where did we leave off with...
Where are you from?
Freddy Wexler, the man who got Billy Joel to record again. I'm from a town called Wayne, New Jersey.
Okay, so East Coast, okay?
Right.
So you'll appreciate this. You said, did I see in his eyes that he was reinvigorated? I don't know, but take this story. So I started going with Billy to most of his shows. And, you know, he's sometimes will take a helicopter, sometimes he will... take a car.
Well, and for those who don't know, Billy performs one show a month at Madison Square Garden. He's been doing so for 10, 15 years, whatever.
Yes, and he's actually about to do he's doing a special. It's his 100th show in this residency. It'll be the CBS special coming up that's amazing. And he'll have done 150 consecutive nights at the Garden, which no one has ever come close to doing.
No.
Once a month for 10 years.
Right.
Insane. Anyway, so I said to him, so how do you want to go to the show? He said, you know what? When was the last time you took the train? I said, the train? You're Billy Joel. I don't know. When was the last time you took the train? And he said, I don't know, when I was in my early 20s. He said, let's do that. Let's take Long Island Railroad. So I literally pick him up. We go to Amagansett, so it was like kind of quiet on there. And we sit on the train, and we go to Penn Station. We change at Jamaica. Billy Joel. We literally get off, change at Jamaica. We get to Penn Station.
Next stop, Ron Kokomo.
Literally. And I kept like, he's eating, you know, he picked up sandwiches from the deli. Like, he's exactly what you want him to be, you know? And so we get to Penn Station, and he goes, oh, I guess we'll go up to the Garden now. Like, we take the escalator up. We go to Penn Station, and it's Billy Joel with the sold-out show. And I'm like, this is insane. So was he reinvigorated? Well, I don't know. He hadn't done that in a while. So I think it made him want to try some different things, maybe, you know?
Well, and what about for you now as a producer? I mean, because,
yeah.
I mean, you said he served as an invigorating tool for you. But how,
yeah.
What's your outlook now on the industry?
Well, a couple things. I think I've always been somebody who thinks anything is possible. But now I really think anything's possible. And, you know, I think people who are born to create art, that's what they're meant to do. And sometimes it's hard to keep doing that. Listen, you got to remember, when you're an artist or a songwriter, your entire livelihood depends on you being inspired one day. Imagine you wake up as a lawyer. I'm not inspired. I can't negotiate the deal. I don't have a job today. It's hard for people to understand that this is the pressure on being an artist. And so I think just remembering that and trying all sorts of different angles to make the process fun for artists and songwriters, including for myself. Sometimes I've lost the fun in music, and I think this whole process has reminded me of two things. One, try to remember that as hard as it is a blessing and a gift to be able to wake up and make music, right? William Wordsworth said, the child is the father of the man. I mean, is there anything else more about your inner child than making art and making music? So you got that. And yeah, I mean, I think that's the biggest thing. Just try to have fun with it, you know?
Freddy Wexler. On behalf of all Billy Joel fans, thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Hope to see you soon again. Wow.